I'm Yuri.
I'm Jakub.
And we're going for a drive. Lincoln Nautilus.
The new MKZ.
So what is this? This is a Ford Edge, but the Lincoln version.
Correct.
Is this like their most popular selling Lincoln?
Probably. It's like the class that everybody buys.
SUV.
Two-row SUVs.
So the big deal with this one is they got rid of that look where the grille kind of went into the headlights, and now they've got the continental style front end.
Yeah, that old look just didn't work.
It was just a weird like in-between Lincoln phase.
Yeah.
I thought it was cool, but not good cool.
This one looks great though.
Yeah, let's start with the looks.
Yeah, let's do it.
Okay, so continental front grille, which I think looks amazing.
Which is now the new Lincoln front grille.
Very metally. It's got these really cool headlights that look amazing.
Yeah, they do.
My favorite part is that when you're looking at it straight on, you can see the lights, and when you move to the side, you can't. So as you're walking by, it feels like it's turning with you.
Yeah, and at night, it looks really nice, just like the Continental and the Navigator, and probably the Aviator.
Yeah, you get anywhere close to this thing, and the lights light up for you.
Do you want to know what my favorite part of the looks is?
Yes.
The wheels.
Okay, yeah.
The turbine style wheels, they work so well.
Very cool.
Yeah, they work so well on this car.
One of my favorite parts, which you may not have noticed, there are very cool body lines right at the front fenders and the rear fenders right above. And I think when the light hits it perfectly, it looks very, very good.
Oh, when the light hits this brown paint perfectly?
Okay, this brown paint's kind of weird. I like it, but it doesn't pop all the time.
Yeah, this is definitely like senior citizen, old person spec.
But it's nice, like beige interior. We got real wood. I'm pretty sure it's real wood.
I'm saying it's real wood.
On Instagram, it was pretty cut down the middle, but like this is real.
This is real, for sure.
But now back to the taillights.
I think they look pretty good.
I like the line all the way across, but the only thing is from a distance, like you don't get that Dodge Durango. I can see the whole back of the light in one shot.
I do agree. There's no Macho Man Randy Savage type thing going on.
Yeah, the way it wraps around, like there's no way to see it all, but it's still very cool.
Yeah, I agree.
Because when you do walk up to it at the back, or when you lock the trunk, the whole light bar comes on and you just feel more special. How about the exhaust tips?
The exhaust tips look all right.
2019 real?
2019 real.
So we've got an exhaust pipe and then a fake thing on the bumper that it goes through, but the exhaust is behind it.
Exactly, so it counts. And besides that, like there's not much to it. Overall, as a package, I think it looks great from the outside.
It definitely looks like a fancy version of the Ford Edge.
Yeah, but it stands out way more than the MKZ or MKZ did before.
Yeah, and I think that's thanks to the headlights, mostly.
Yeah, and the grille.
Yeah, the whole package, okay.
The grille. The grille is what made the old one look so bad.
Yeah. Now I wanna talk about something I rarely talk about, and that's like the horn honking stuff. So I talked about it in a Volvo video recently. This car, if you get out of the car with the key in your pocket, it honks so loudly at you.
It's kind of embarrassing.
Like it's, bad up! Like holy, chill, like you're a luxury brand, use cool digital beep beep.
Yeah, or even the same horn, but mute it, just like beep beep.
Yeah, somebody does that.
Yes.
I forget who, but that exists.
It does.
What's also very interesting about taking the key out of this car, you can't drive this car with no key in it. A lot of cars will let you.
Exactly, so if the car's already running and you don't have the key in it, this car will not let you go into drive.
But other cars, they'll let you, they'll just beep, key not in vehicle.
So you can drive forever, keep it running forever, go to gas stations, go like a million miles, never turn it off, and you can just take the car.
So like, you can just let this car warm up places and not worry about someone stealing it. This would be the worst bait car.
Yeah, that's true.
No one would be able to steal it.
Yeah, good call.
So like, it's weird, but cool.
All right, Yuri, what do you want to talk about next before I drive?
Seats, infotainment, engage.
Deal.
Start with the seats.
Okay.
We've got the crazy multiple adjustable seats. I kind of don't like them. You can get comfortable sometimes, but I'm having a hard time like just really feeling comfy in these.
Yeah, so I straight up hate these seats. I loved them in the Navigator, and in the Continental, they were completely fine. So I don't know what they did here, if they changed manufacturers, or if they're just completely different seats, but I can't get comfortable no matter what I do. I'm always just like fiddling over here. No, like a little bit back, no. Oh, and then if I press a button, I gotta adjust the rest of it through my infotainment, which is a little bit frustrating.
Yeah, I'm trying to adjust my lumbar, then like 17 lumbars show up, but the massage is really, really good. I really, really, really enjoy this massage.
I agree, but how do we get to the massage? You fiddle with your seat settings down to the side.
Until
and then
it prompts itself up.
Yeah, and then if I'm trying to adjust my massage, Yuri can't adjust his massage until I'm done.
Or the radio, or seats, or anything.
Yeah, so if he wants to change his seat settings while I'm getting a massage, no.
So I want to try the regular seats. I think that'd be nice.
Yeah, I agree. I don't know how necessary these are, but if you're into massages, just get them for the massage and just kind of deal with the rest of the seats.
Yeah, try it out. Definitely try it out.
Yes.
Now to the infotainment, we have Sync 3. Same old thing we have in every single Ford, but this one's got a nice little brown coloring instead of blue to match the luxuriness of wood and
Pretty much brown.
It's pretty whatever. It's got Apple CarPlay, Android Auto, can't rewind satellite radio stations.
It does it live. Let's just clarify that.
Yeah, that doesn't count. And we have a lot of hard buttons to go with it for our climate and everything. Very similarly to the Edge, we can't control where the fan blows unless we go into our climate settings.
We also have a heated steering wheel in here, and you can find it on the home screen, so fair enough, but there's no physical button for it. However, if you missed it in the home screen, you go to climate. So you're assuming that your climate controls your heated steering wheel, because that's a fair assumption, but it's nowhere to be found there until you go to your extra climate settings and it's buried in there.
Yeah, but we do have a hard button for heated and cooled seats, which we can't use at the same time. We know why sometimes I want that.
Yes.
But we do have a really, really nice volume and tuning knob. Very nice.
I fully agree with that.
Below all the infotainment and gauges, we do have this little compartment for your cell phone. The best part is it'll hold your cell phone and you can plug it into there to use Apple CarPlay, close it, and then you never have to even see your phone, which is great for people who are tempted by their phones while driving.
And then it also has wireless charging. And then, unlike the Ford Edge, which wasted a little bit of space down here with the shifter, we have it up on the dash.
Yeah, the hard button shifting things are cool. It's kind of a Lincoln thing to do. I don't mind it. I got used to it.
Exactly.
So on the left, we've got park, rear, neutral, drive, and sport. And on the right, we've got auto start, stop, off, automatic parking, camera, parking sensors, and our hazards. So let's get into the automatic parking real quick. It works fine. You saw me park this thing today, no hands, killed it.
Took a little long, but it worked.
Did I use my hands?
No.
Exactly.
But it took a little long.
Luxury. Now to our camera. We've got a 360 camera, and it'll show 360 camera while reversing. However,
the resolution.
Low res. Luxury cars can't have low res cameras.
Because this has the Ford resolution, because we also had this on the F-250.
Yeah, and the same quality as the Edge reverse camera.
Yeah, but the Edge did not have a 360 camera.
Like, come on, guys. Luxury brands, HD.
Get those resolutions up. We got 8K screens. We got like 16K screens. And we can't even get like 240p.
Come on. Now to the gauges. They look cool. When they start up, they got a nice gradient animation. It has a little bit of banding and compression, which I think is weird because we're not live streaming to the car. But whatever, it looks cool. So the gauges are very classy looking. They're simple, fully digital. I kind of like them, but there are some things that are kind of weird about them.
I actually have a huge complaint about them, so I would like to drive and show you what I'm talking about.
Let's do it.
Gauge complaint. I have to press the settings button on the steering wheel, then I have to go to my drive control, then I have to customize the handling in D, S, and the performance in S. That is the only way to customize your actual driving mode in S mode, because we have a D and an S in hard buttons, so everything's buried in the infotainment, but not the actual infotainment, in the gauge cluster.
But to be fair, does this car warrant having to change from drive to sport?
No,
and customizing?
Absolutely not.
So you don't even need to use that?
No, exactly. That's why, like, just give me the D and S and that's it. But this is just ridiculous. Yeah, just remove that setting. But this does have adaptive suspension, so I wanted to feel what it was like, and then I found out that it didn't really make that much of a difference. So yeah, you're right, just delete that setting from the menus.
Okay, but back to the gauges. We do have tach on the left, speed on the right. We could have just normal speed in the middle, and then we can have speed in the middle with eco coaching. So there'll be a little green thing that shows you where you should be for optimal economy, which I think is way better than that confusing thing in the Volvos.
Yeah, I agree with you there. Overall, I do like the gauges. Now let's talk about the driving. I'm always gonna leave it in drive because this is a luxury SUV. I don't really need sport. The suspension is very comfortable if you leave it in comfort. So I'm going to do a comfort send in the cliche and it'll be completely fine. There's tons of body roll, but I actually find it funny because the Edge ST had pretty much no body roll, so it's nice to see that they actually made that much of a difference with the Edge ST compared to this.
But you want to know something similar between the Edge ST and this?
What's that?
The transmission and those paddles.
Yeah, so we have the exact same 8-speed auto, and the paddles work exactly the same. They don't work very well, but this is a luxury SUV, so I don't even want to use these paddles.
But in the Edge ST, it had that weird thing where, like, first, second, and third didn't really do anything, and it just kind of skipped through gears in like a CVT.
Yep.
Same thing here.
Yes, it is.
Second, third, fourth. But it's like, wait, shouldn't the gears go down when it upshifts?
Yeah.
Apparently not.
Exactly. So just leave it in drive. Don't touch the paddles. Everything's fine.
But is it quick?
It's pretty quick.
Like, I feel just as fast as I was in the Edge ST. So, you know, like, whatever.
Well, let's talk about that engine. We have a 2-liter four-cylinder turbo pumping out 250 horsepower and 280 pound-feet of torque.
But you can get the larger motor if you'd like.
Yeah, exactly, which is nice. You can get that 2.7 liter V6 twin turbo just like the one in the Ford Edge ST. It's the exact same engine. You just have to pay to get it in this one.
Interesting.
I honestly don't think you need it in this. No. This is completely adequate.
This was just as fast almost as like, the MDX.
Yeah, exactly. And there's not much turbo lag. Like, it's completely fine. I really like this engine. It's a very good choice for this car.
Speaking of very good for this car, I was using the Lane Keep Assist while using cruise control. This is so fantastic. It works great. I definitely want to include this into my comparison of cruise controls.
You keep saying yours. It's our comparison.
Yeah, but it's in my head.
It's in my head too.
It's Gardner. I have a full plan. You don't even know about this plan. Don't worry about it. But it is very good. But have you noticed when you're in the luxury brand, it doesn't yell at you as often to put your hands on the steering wheel?
No, I haven't noticed that.
Like the Infiniti compared to a Nissan.
Okay,
or
yeah.
Or this compared to a Ford.
Yeah, okay, fair enough.
And then like the S-Class compared to non-S-Class Mercedes. Like the more you pay for a Lane Keep Assist, the less they bark at you.
The more autonomous it is.
Yeah. Well, it's the same autonomy, they just don't bark at you as much.
Yeah, I guess, but it lets, yeah, fine. But I do have a complaint about the transmission, and it just has to do with the paddles themselves. They feel so cheap, like the plasticiest paddles ever, and the left one feels like it's like flimsy. You pointed that out.
Yeah, someone needs to tighten that Phillips screw. Or
yeah, so like the quality's kind of not really there.
Nah, there's no screws.
No. But the rest of the buttons are good. We got some wood on the steering wheel. The steering wheel leather feels really nice. The seat leather feels really nice. The wood trim looks really nice. The cup holders, I don't know if they pass. Yuri, let me know.
We've got a medium McDonald's because that's what I hit up this morning.
And it passes fully.
Don't know about the small. Don't care today.
I think it would pass.
Yeah, probably.
Let's throw that out. And let's find out about the visors.
3, 2, 1.
Yes. Good job. Yeah.
Lincoln was the one that had the sign at the auto show.
Yes, it is.
Probably box test now?
Yeah, I guess we should do that. 12. Want your name on a box? Just like that? Go to patreon.com/thestraightpipes. Overall, the interior quality is quite decent. It's definitely a step up from the Edge. However, the interior space, they couldn't do anything about, and I feel very cramped in here.
It does feel a little claustrophobic, but we do have a lot of compartments like in this center dash thing.
Yeah.
And I also noticed compared to the Edge, at the top of the dash in the Edge, we had a nice compartment that we could store stuff in. Here, it's a Revel speaker instead.
Yeah, so we do have the optional Revel Ultima system, and it's pretty booming, I'd say.
And the side speaker covers and this wood reminds me a lot of Mercedes, to be honest.
Yeah, the speaker covers in the wood, I agree. And this car competes with Mercedes and all the German brands, right? Even for price, like everything is up there. So they really kind of have to step everything up, especially that reverse camera.
Yeah, oh yeah, for sure. What do you think of the back seat room?
Exactly the same as the Ford Edge.
Cool.
Watch that video. And speaking of the Ford Edge briefly again, I think this driving position is a little bit better. Those seats in the Ford Edge were so uncomfortable that I felt like I was higher. This, I feel like I'm slightly lower.
I think it's because you're in a luxury car and you know it, so you don't expect to be as sporty.
No,
it's probably the exact same.
I'm looking at my driving position and stuff, it feels like I'm a little bit lower.
I don't have a measuring tape on.
I don't either, but that's what it feels like.
And we do have a big moonroof.
Yeah, we do, which is quite nice again.
So I guess let's talk about the price.
We probably should, because that might be the biggest deciding factor whether you should get this car or not. Starts at $50,000.
Canadian.
This one's $69,200.
Seems like a lot for this.
Yeah, there's a lot of players in that game at that price range, and that is kind of the problem with this car. If you priced it cheaper, fine, but Lincoln doesn't want you to think that it's a cheaper luxury brand, so they have to price it just like everybody else.
To be honest, I'd rather just take the Santa Fe that we had.
That wasn't even a luxury brand.
I know, that's the weird thing.
Yeah, that's kind of fair.
Better 360 cameras, and it's got the front wheel camera, the rear wheel camera, winding satellite radio stations.
But this competes with like a Porsche, a Macan, a Cayenne, not really. Cayenne would be the size, but not price. An Audi Q5, it definitely competes on price. An SQ5 even. It competes with BMW, the X3, X5. Like, there's a lot of competitors in that space.
You know, considering this has old Sync 3, it's like not even on my list. Like, I would rather take a Dodge Ram interior than a lot of this stuff.
I don't mind the Sync 3, like I said, but the fact that the steering wheel stuff is buried in there and then the gauge stuff is buried in the gauges, like, it's very frustrating to use this.
It's just weird.
Yeah, pretty much.
So much weird stuff.
Yeah.
But compared to a Macan, I think the looks are like pretty on point. Like, if you want the American luxury version instead of the German luxury version, like, you're in the right ballpark.
Yeah, I guess. But I mean, I would still take a Macan day, even the base Cayenne. But Cayenne, again, a little bit higher price. Yeah.
So I guess let us know what you think of the new Lincoln Nautilus.
Yeah, let us know. I do like the name of it, by the way.
I think it's a shrimp.
Yeah, I don't think so.
Don't forget to subscribe, hit the notification bell.
Join patreon.com/thestraightpipes for early access to videos, and join our YouTube membership as well.
Hit the like button and share it with your friends, and leave a comment.
Most importantly, share it with your friends.
Very importantly. I'm Yuri.
I'm Jakub.
And we're going for a drive.
Don't forget to subscribe.
Subscribe right now. Subscribe.
We didn't do that.